Hello there, welcome to today's session. Today we are going to discuss about Mimamsa School of Indian Philosophy. According to Mimamsa School, a valid knowledge is something that is obtained from fresh information. It shouldn't be contradicted by any other knowledge in this world. Not only that, it shouldn't be due to any defective condition of our eyes. Say for example, jaundiced eyes. So they will never ever consider such kinds of information that you gather as valid knowledge. Okay, there should be something fresh about it if they want to accept it as a valid knowledge. Are you getting it? Well, this Mimamsa school is divided into two, Prabhakara school and Bhatta school. Prabhakara school and Bhatta school follows five pramanas. Okay, and I believe you already know what are pramanas. Pramanas are the methods using which you reach onto the truth of a knowledge. Okay, so they follow five pramanas and they are perception, inference, comparison, testimony and postulation. There is an exception for this Bhatta school, okay? Because Bhatta school follows one more pramana, okay? And that pramana is non-perception. So altogether, Prabhakara school follows five perceptions and the Bhatta school follows six perceptions. Are you getting it? But anyway, the way they follow it, okay, that is the same. So we will get into a detailed study about all these pramanas, how Mimamsa school actually takes into consideration these pramanas, okay, in finding out the truth of a knowledge. Mimamsa school divides knowledge into two categories, like many other schools had already done, and these divisions are immediate knowledge and immediate knowledge. So you have come across with the same idea in the Jaina school already. So it's the same here too, okay? Immediate knowledge is called extraordinary and extrasensory type of knowledge, okay? And immediate knowledge is just ordinary case of knowledge. So what is the basic difference between these two? In extraordinary or extrasensory kind of knowledge, that is immediate knowledge, what happens is soul directly enters and cognizes the knowledge. Are you getting it? So the soul understands this knowledge without the help of our sense organs or our mind. Are you getting it? That's why it is called extrasensory or extraordinary. So this immediate knowledge is divided into three: avadhi, manaparyaya and kevala. In avadhi, things are known from a distance of space and time. Okay, but it has some limitations because it is limited to, you know, a particular area. So a mind cannot understand these information beyond a particular area, and it is susceptible to errors too. Okay, it's not 100% valid knowledge. The first one, that is called avadhi. Second case that we had discussed just now is manaparyaya. What happens over here is, you know, you are able to know the thoughts of another person, okay? And it also is, you know, limited to space and time. Are you getting it? But this is taken as error-free. Well, third is kevala. In kevala, okay, the soul actually enters into unlimited and absolute knowledge without the finite conditions of space and time. So the soul has ultimate knowledge, ultimate unlimited knowledge about anything and everything that is going around in the universe. Are you getting it? How beautiful and how fascinating is actually Indian philosophy. Well, so these are the immediate cases of knowledge. And coming to mediate case, mediate knowledge, it is divided into two, Madhi and Shruta. Okay, Madhi is the knowledge that we obtain through senses or mind. Okay, that's why this mediate knowledge is ordinary. Okay, it is something that can be understood by the physical self of a human being, not by the soul. Are you getting it? It do not require the help of the soul. Okay. Well, in Shruta, Shruta knowledge actually is obtained from authority. Okay. Through Shabda, as the name suggests, through Shabda, that is testimony. Okay. An authoritative person, a statement given by an authoritative person. Well, moving on to first pramana, that is perception. Perception over here is called immediate knowledge. Okay, inside Mimamsa school, immediate means it is extrasensory. So what happens in perception is an object is coming into contact with your senses or your mind, and then you cognize that object, okay, and reach up to the validity, okay, to the valid knowledge about it. Mimamsa school also follows two steps of perception, okay. One is indeterminate or nirvikalpa, and the second is determinate or savikalpa. So we had already discussed it in the Nyaya school, and it's the same over here too. Okay, in indeterminate kind of perception, you have just confronted the object in front of you. You have not formed into the truth of it. You have not reached onto a judgment about the object in front of you. And in determinate kind of perception, what happens is you have formed a judgment. Okay, after analysis, you have found out what it is. So right now the judgment is very clear. The object in front of you is very clear. This is the second stage, and this is, you remember, this is the two stages of thought process that happens inside our mind. Are you getting it? Moving on to the second pramana of Mimamsa school, which is inference. See, the case of inference in Mimamsa school is as such as it is followed by the Nyaya school. So I had already done a detailed discussion about inference of Nyaya school in one video. I will be putting the link, okay, here. You just click and watch it and study it. Moving on to the next one, which is called comparison. Mimamsa school considers comparison as an independent means to reach valid knowledge. Well, when you compare their case with the Nyaya school, there is a slight difference. Do you remember the example that was given in Nyaya school in the case of comparison? In Nyaya school, we had already studied that, comparison happens when you compare the information that you have received from an authoritative person with an object that is in front of you. So the example that we had discussed in that class was actually about a cow. Okay, about cow, when you just know a cow, and out of the words of a person of authority, you gain this knowledge that a wild cow is actually an animal, that looks like a cow. Okay, and then you go into the forest and you happen to see an animal over there. You infer to that person's knowledge and understand that this animal in front of you in that forest is a wild cow or gavaya. Are you getting it? But here we have a difference. Here the point is, you know a cow already, okay, because you have seen it at home, and then you go into the forest. Okay, you go over there and you meet an animal over there. And what happens is you actually compare your own past knowledge. Okay, how you knew that cow. You just compare that knowledge that you already have, and you then go for a checking of similarity between your memory and the present object in front of you, and fix that, okay, this is actually a wild cow. Are you getting it? The process that is undergone is actually this upamana or comparison. And I hope it is clear. Let us discuss the testimony, which is the next pramana. The entire philosophy of Mimamsa school actually revolves around Vedic ritualism. So basically, Vedas are, or you know, it's really, really important for them to establish the relevance of Vedas. Okay, and you have already studied in the other schools of philosophy what is this testimony all about. usually a testimony will have two classifications, okay, and one of the two will be, of course, which denotes the authority of Vedas. Okay, so here too that is the case. According to the Mimamsa school, every meaningful statement, okay, that itself is a testimony. But there is an exception. They will never ever consider any statement which is coming from a person without an authority, okay, from an unreliable person or an untrustworthy person. So this testimony should come from an authoritative person, then only they will consider that, okay, that as a pramana. This is their principle of testimony, remember that, okay. And like all the other school that we had already discussed, Mimamsa school divides this testimony into two, okay, Paurusheya and Apaurusheya. Paurusheya means personal and Apaurusheya means impersonal. Okay, Paurusheya means, you know, those statements which are coming from human sources. So the point is, it is not at all error free. Okay, errors can happen, and the criteria is they only consider testimony from an authoritative person. The second category is Apaurusheya. It denotes the authority of Vedas. Okay, and Mimamsa school takes them as, that is the Vedas, as beyond all doubt, error or contradiction, just because according to them Vedas are eternal and orderless. It's not just according to them, whole Indian philosophical system, it considers Vedas as orderless and eternal. Okay, it has some divine origin. We're getting it. Moving on to the next pramana. Well, I just want to add one more idea to testimony. This testimony is again divided into two. Okay, there are two kinds of testimony. One that gives us knowledge of an object, or the other case which gives us commands on doing or performing certain actions. Okay, well, Mimamsa school actually has an elaborate body, okay, of words, its meanings and its relations that actually substantiate the relevance of Veda or the authority of Vedas. And anyway, we do not have that for discussion just because it is not prescribed in your text. Okay, thank God. Let us move on to the next one called postulation. Postulation is also considered as one of the independent pramanas followed by Mimamsa school. Postulation actually means implication, presumption or arthapati. Okay, so what happens in postulation is this: when two inconsistent realities are coming in front of us and we are not able to come into a particular conclusion so as to read the truth of that situation, then we rely upon this postulation. Okay, so the point over here is this: we just cannot reach on to the conclusion by using perception or testimony or comparison and the like. Okay, the only choice left is actually that of postulation. The example given over here is very, very interesting. See, imagine that you are meeting a person who is fast. Okay, fasting, you know what is the meaning of it. He abstains from having food during daytime. But at the same time, you observe that this man is actually putting on weight. Okay, how will you explain such a condition? Okay, that's the case that is given as the example over here. So the point is, if a person is not at all having food, but at the same time he is actually putting on weight, okay, he is getting fat day by day, that actually gives you this kind of an explanation that this man might be eating food during night. Am I correct? That is the only case that is applicable over here. Without eating food, a man can never ever be fat. Am I correct? So this is the case of postulation. We presume such a case, and we often do it, okay, during our day-to-day conversation. If you are going to meet a friend in his home, and you go over there and make the enquiry, but you come to know that the friend is not too present inside home, then you also go for such a kinds of arthapadi or presumptions or implications or postulation. Am I correct? You will assume that okay, he might have gone out for some shopping or for some other needs or requirements. Am I correct? So this is exactly what is called postulation. Okay, and this postulation is again, this arthapadi is again divided into two. Okay, shrutarthapadi and drishtarthapadi. Okay, drishtarthapadi is actually used to explain visual contradiction. Okay, drishtarthapadi. Shrutarthapadi is actually used to explain inconsistency in the meaning of words. Okay, when you make use of words and you see a kind of inconsistency in it, a kind of inappropriateness in it, then that case is drishtarthapadi. Okay, so if you cannot go for a logical reasoning, you actually go for some other kind of reasoning that will be a possibility over there. That is the only choice that is left. And I hope that's clear. Moving on to the next. So these are the five pramanas followed, or I would say equally shared by Prabhakara Mimamsa and Bhatta Mimamsas. Okay, perception, inference, comparison, testimony and postulation. And we had discussed in the outset that Bhatta Mimamsa actually follows one more pramana, and that pramana is called non-perception. Okay, so you remember we are going to discuss about that last part in Mimamsa school, which is a pramana followed only by Bhatta Mimamsa. Okay, it is called non-perception. Well, so before going into a detailed study of this non-perception, I just want to talk about the idea called perception. Okay, so perception involves the sense object contact. Okay, you should be able to sense it. Okay, you are sensing an object using the senses that is available to you, and you understand that subject matter. But what is happening inside non-perception, that is the issue over here. Okay, so Bhatta Mimamsa actually admit non-perception as an independent pramana. So that means that you just cannot make use of inference, comparison or testimony or perception. Okay, over here as an aid to reach on to the reality of a knowledge, when you just consider non-perception as a pramana. The example given over here is very interesting again. See, you can perceive a pot and substantiate the existence of a pot like that. Okay, if a pot is placed in front of you, you can say that it is a pot just because you can see it and it is placed in front of you. Are you getting it? But the question is, how do you prove the absence of a pot? Okay, so you are here to prove the absence of a pot. If you are asked to prove the presence of a pot, then that is okay. You can perceive it and say that, okay, this pot is over here. Then how do you talk about the absence? So normally what happens in Mimamsa school is this. Just because, you know, if you just say that you just cannot perceive it using your eyes, and that means it is not existing, then you are making use of this pramana called inference over here. And if you consider that case, what happens is you are actually going for that universal relation or vyapti between non-perception and non-existence of that object. Okay, so what you do in such a cases, you are actually again depending upon the pramana called inference. So that cannot be used over here just because non-perception is an independent pramana. Are you getting it? You can't even make use of comparison or testimony too. Okay, so over here, Mimamsa school actually considers non-perception, okay, as an independent pramana through which we get the knowledge of non-existence. Okay, so simply, if something is non-perceptive, that means that it is non-existing. Are you getting it? But anyway, there are, you know, certain exceptions in this pramana. You know what, you know, you just cannot go and say that everything in the world that you cannot perceive using your eyes are not at all existing. You know, you just consider the same example of the pot, okay, under a different, totally different environment. For example, you place the you place the pot in darkness. You go and check it out. Over there, you cannot perceive it using your eyes. And there, you cannot say or argue that the pot is actually absent in that room. Then again, the case of atoms, ether, etc. Just because these are imperceptible things, you cannot argue that they are not existing. Are you getting it? Just because you cannot see it using your bare eyes, naked eyes, you cannot argue that they are non-existing. Are you getting it? So, the point is, non-perception should be qualified by yogyata or fitness inside mimamsa. Okay. Non-perception should be qualified by yogyata or fitness. So the point is, if you are going to talk about the non-perception, okay, perception of a particular object, then the situation should be like this, okay. The object should be perceptible under certain situations, and under some other situations, you know, the object is not perceptible. So in that case, you can actually go and say that over here, just because you cannot perceive the object is just not over there. Are you getting it? So this is what is meant by non-perception as admitted by Bhatta Mimamsa. So non-perception is an independent pramana through which we actually get the knowledge of non-existence. Okay, they have a kind of exception over here, then do not qualify everything under the same thing, okay, the same principle. There are exceptions according to you know, the difference in the situation. Okay, so it should qualify fitness or yogyata to classify an object, the absence of an object as you know, non-existing using the pramana called non-perception. So I hope all the points that we have discussed in this session are clear with you. If you have any clarifications or doubts, you can place it in the comment box. Thank you for listening. Okay, see, I will be placing those notes on that session on inference, which I had already done, okay, in the Nyaya school, as part of Nyaya school, as an end card. Okay, so go through that and prepare well. So with this, I am Mona signing off. Thank you.